As I think about this series and I think about the time since Martin Luther King to today, the stories that you're telling of Black America are not the elite Black America stories, or at least that exclusively, or mostly.
No.
Right.
No.
So you come to the task of telling the story of a Black America that is, in many respects, not your Black America.
Right. Well, it's all my Black America, but Black America is multifaceted.
Yeah, and no more monolithic point than white America. Right.
There are more African Americans than all the people in Canada.
Is that right?
There are 42 million African Americans. Somebody can, right now, you can Google. I think there are 36 million Canadians.
Yeah.
Yet we use metaphors like the community for Afro-America.
Right.
It's a country.
Right.
Donald
Trump says the blacks.
The blacks, yeah.
Which sounds like 10 people.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
But Martin Delaney, I believe in 1852, the father of black nationalism, said, "We are a nation within a nation." That was 1852.
Yeah.
And it's true. And so we can never expect 42 million people to be in the same economic class. But that's what our rhetoric has suggested. Somehow we were going to dismantle de jure segregation and all of us would plunge headlong into the middle class. It's an oxymoron.
Yeah.
It never was going to be that way. The best outcome that we could achieve would be the class distribution within the race would look like it looks for the larger white American community or the broader American community.
Right.
So the same percentage of people in the 1%, let's say, would be 1%.
And we would have people in poverty as we have people in poverty who are white.
Right. And and we don't have that. While there are twice as many poor people in America who are white, the percentage is about half. You see?
Yeah.
More than 20% of the black community lives in poverty, and it's just over 10% for the white community.
Right.
But more than 20 million white Americans live in poverty.
Right. Well, the white community has had, as they say, a head start.
Yeah, absolutely.
In terms of getting out of poverty.
And I grew up in the hills of West Virginia on the Potomac River.
Right.
You know, that farm is on the south branch of the Potomac River, not where I was born, but where my dad was born.
Yeah.
All my ancestors back 250 years on all sides of my family lived within a 30-mile radius of where I was born. I have a very stable and old and free black family.
Yeah.
But the people I grew up with were poor white people, were working-class white people.
Right.
So I know that the patterns of behavior that stem from structural poverty are colorblind.
Yeah, regardless of race.
If we ever get the poor people in this country to realize that they have more in common with each other, and that demagogues, they can resist the siren call of demagogues who make them think that their poverty is the result of the conspiracy of 12 rabbis who rule the world, or all the black people, or Mexicans coming across
the border. Rapists.
Or 1.6 billion Muslims.
Right.
If they can resist that siren call of evil and realize that what appears to be far too often in this country attributable to race is really an economic problem.
Right.
And forge alliances, they could transform.
Well, in fact, the political power of people in poverty, if we could persuade people in poverty to avail themselves of that democratic right to vote, and they voted in their interest.
Right, in their interest.
Voted in their interest. You would get, and we know that voter turnout is often predicted as much by poverty as anything that tends to, but you could think about the power of not just black poverty, but white poverty marshaled. It would change the country.
Right. If they could vote their interests, as you say, instead of their fears.